my case with even later on.
Let's just stand up and go shake each other's hands and bless each other. We are a friend of God.
Take it back. I'm done. I'm happy to do it from here. Mike wants none, so Mike is over there, but I don't like the setting over there. I'll do it from here. Okay. If he wants it over there, I'll switch it over to you. How's that?
Okay.
Our God is greater, Father. for God to do great things upon the earth.
Amen.
We're not excited for what God's doing.
Yeah.
You know, the Bible says in Luke 3:15, it says, they were in a state of expectation. How many have some expectation tonight? God really wants to put expectation in your heart to believe for the ridiculous. You know, this is a time that we declare God's word, believe God's word. Walk in holiness and repentance, you know. God is looking to and fro throughout the whole earth to find those hearts that are truly His. And you know what? God's looking for those people. And tonight as we begin to worship God as it is in heaven. How many know there's things going on in heaven that are coming to the earth? You know, last week we had communion with bread that showed up from heaven. You know, last week we had bread show up from heaven. We had communion. So God's doing all kinds of fun things, you know. And I just get excited for what God's doing, you know. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Sing a new song of the same.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hey, Tom, how's those knees feeling from last week?
Don't hurt anymore.
Tell what, come give a testimony. Go over here, Tom. Give a testimony of what God did last week. How many like testimonies?
Yeah!
Glory to God.
Well, as I was leaving, got warming feeling and...
What was wrong with your leg? Something was wrong with them.
Well, I've still got cartilage gone.
No cartilage.
But my knees stopped hurting.
And they hurt,
for years. And I haven't had pain since.
Wow. Last Friday night got healed. Hallelujah. Give Jesus a hand. Hallelujah.
That was when Nicole was playing the keyboard, right, Tom?
Yes.
It was during that time. Yeah.
Praise God. Anybody else could hear healed last week or such a change last week when you're here? How many expect miracles?
Yes.
So we're going to play Healing Rain here in a minute by Michael W. Smith, but I want to read a passage of scripture first out of Psalm 42. If the fan don't blow the pages all over. It's my favorite fan. It says, as a deer pants for the water brook, so my soul pants after you, O Lord. You know what? We got to pant after the Lord. We got to go. We want to. We need Jesus Christ more than our next breath. How many know that?
Yeah.
We really need Jesus Christ more than our next breath. We got to have that kind of passion for God. So desperate. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. He's not a dead God. How many know he's not dead? You know, I remember back in the 60s. I remember when I was about, I don't know, 12 years old, 11 years old, I saw the Seattle Times. God is dead. I want you to know God is not dead. God, I remember that when I was like a kid. God is dead. My God ain't dead. Their God's dead. My God's living. My God's alive. And he's, like how Lindsay said, he's alive and well on planet Earth. Not the devil, but God. Hallelujah. But when I would come and appear before God, my tears have been my food day and night. While they continually say to me, where is your God? When I remember these things, I pour my soul within me. For I used to go to the multitude. I went to them to the house of God with a voice of joy and praise, with the multitude that kept the pilgrim feast. How many like to have an attitude of joy and praise?
Yes.
God wants you not to have an attitude of joy. And you know, the joy of the Lord is your what?
Strength.
And His presence is the fullness of what?
Joy.
So rejoice the Lord always, and again I say,
rejoice.
I mean, you guys know your word, praise God. And I went to the house of God with the voice of joy and praise of the multitude that kept a pilgrim feast. Why are you cast down on my soul? Why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall yet praise Him for the help of His countenance. You know, when you get cast down, you know what? Hope in God. There's hope in Jesus. How many of those hope in God?
Amen.
I'm working on a painting I'm just about done with, but God says, there's a movie marquee, it says Jesus is coming to your city, but Lord says, put hope on the side. How many know God's a God of hope?
Yes.
God's a God of hope. God's a God of abundance, and God wants to give you hope for all that He's about to do, and so faith is the substance of the things, the conviction of the things not seen. Now faith is. It says now. It's not tomorrow. It's right now. Right now. Right now. Oh my God, my soul's cast down within me. Therefore I remember you from the land of the Jordan, and from the heights of Hermon, from the hills of Mizar. Deep calls on the deep at the sound of many waterfalls. How many of those some deep things that God's bringing up? You know what the thing is? It was in the water that God, in Genesis 1:2, God breathed over the water, and He looked at the water, and out of the water came forth creation. How many know, out of that water, in Genesis 1, the first few verses, creation came when God breathed on that water. That water moved upon, God moved, the water moved, the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the deep, and God began to create the universe. I tell you, there's some deep things. At the sound of many waterfalls, you'd be sitting there worshiping God, and you'd feel the waterfall going over you. All of a sudden, creation will be all over you. The things of God will be all over you. You're going to be pulling forth the deep things of God. And there's some. How many know some deep things? Man, get your waders on. We're going to wade deep. Hallelujah. There's some deep things, man. And so get ready for God to do some deep things. The Lord will command His loving kind. I love this. I missed the verse, I think. All His waves and billows have gone over me. The Lord commands His loving kindness in the daytime. How many of God says, He commands His loving kindness? I don't feel no one loves me. God don't love me. He loves me not. He loves me not. God says, man, I command my loving kindness. Yes. You know what? There's a promise. God says, Lord, the steadfast love of God is new every way.
Morning.
Great is Thy
faith.
faith. It's new every morning.
Yeah.
It's new every day.
Yeah.
And God wants you not to drink of the love of God. You know, if we love the Lord, you know what? We'll obey God. If we love the Lord, we'll do what He says to do. If we love the Lord, like our brother Merritt just called, because God says, God told him, go into all the world and preach the gospel. It says, and Merritt, he says, I don't have to have an invitation. God just says, go. I don't know. I don't ever feel called to go. I just go because God says to go. That's Merritt. He's just a Pakistan or India. Now he's over in Uganda. He called up tonight. He says, pray for tomorrow. So pray for tomorrow. 9 o'clock tomorrow, they're having, they've had over 800 salvations. He called me early tonight during service. 800 come to Christ, and they're having a big miracle service in Uganda tomorrow. So 9 o'clock in the morning, our time, there's a big crusade going on their time that night. So believe God with our brother Merritt that signs and wonders of miracle will follow him in Uganda tomorrow now. Because you know what? Because God, when he commands his loving kindness, he just can't help but to heal you. He just can't help but to bless you. He just can't help but to pour his love upon you, because God's a God of love. He's a God of love. And he's just longing for you to come and spend more time, and run away with you, beloved. Shabbat. And he commands his loving kindness in the daytime, and in the night his song shall be with me.
Yeah.
How many love just lay in bed at night just singing Jesus?
God.
Or you just sitting in your car just singing?
Yeah.
Lord, give me a new song. Give me a spontaneous song. Give me a song to drive my kids nuts.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
Glory to God. And it does. Oh, shut up, man. What are you doing singing? But God, give me a new song. You know, put a song in your heart, you know? Hallelujah. And pray to God all my life. I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why do you go out mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? As with the breaking of my bones, my enemies reproach me. But they say to me all day long, where is your God? Where is your God? How many know? I know where my God is. He's all around me. He's in me. He's through me. He's everywhere. Why are you cast down on my soul? Why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God. When you go into the dark night of the soul where things don't seem to go right, says God, I'm going to trust in you. Lean not unto your own understanding, but all thy ways acknowledge him, and he's going to direct your path. You know, he desires, the Bible says in Colossians, that he wants to have preeminence, first place in your life. Jesus doesn't want to be second fiddle, you know that? He wants to be first place in your life. He wants to be first place, not second or third. Why are you casting on my soul? Why are you disquiet within me? Hope in God, for I shall yet praise him. How many are going to praise God? The help of my countenance and my God. You know, and so, but during this song, Healing Rain, you got need a healing. You don't even need anyone. You just need to reach out to Jesus. You just need to touch the hem of his garment. The one with the issue of blood. If I just touch the hem of his garment, Jesus, who touched me? Who touched me? I felt power and virtue go out from me. You know what? She had such faith to pull on Jesus Christ. And tonight, if you have a need, pull on the Lord. You just worship God as God. You're the God that meets every need. God, you're the God of the all-sufficient one. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, that your healing rain is falling down. We thank you for your healing rain, Father. Lord, we just thank you for your healing rain, Father. We just praise you. Lord, we're just amazed by who you are tonight, God. We're just amazed by your glory. We're amazed by your love tonight, oh God.
You are enthroned above the heavens, the earth and all creation.
Bow before you. You are crowned with strength and glory, the angels cry and holy, all surround.
Oh,
were just worshiping. I just kept hearing this thing going in my spirit. It's something I shared a few weeks ago. And a few weeks ago, I had a dream. And in my I'm not going to share the whole dream, but in the dream, I was with my former church and former pastors and all this kind of things. And things are going on in the dream. And I woke up from the dream. Long story short, I says, God, what was that dream about? And the Lord spoke to me. He says, don't let your past prevent your future.
Yeah,
don't let your past, right. And you know, here Jesus comes to Peter, says, Peter, Satan has demanded to see if God is weak, but I've prayed for you.
Yeah.
And after you turn, strengthen the brethren. Some here have gone through maybe divorces, you've gone through this. I remember as a kid, you know, you had, some folks here have fears right now. Your fears are stopping you from your future. I remember as a kid, I had a bedwetting problem. You know, I mean, I wet my bed. I remember I had an opportunity to go to San Francisco with my uncle, but I didn't want to go for fear of wetting the bed. You know, I just didn't want to wet somebody else's bed. So that stopped me from my future. It stopped me from something I would have really enjoyed. You know, there's things in our life that are stopping some of you tonight. And God wants to set some of you free. He wants to set you free. He says, don't let your past prevent your future. I don't care if you've gone through addictions, you know, if you've had an abortion in the past or something's gone on. And the devil's trying to hold you and pin you down with something in your past. And that's going to stop you. God wants you free from your past. In fact, the other day I was praying and the Lord was, you know, should be converted. It was last Saturday, I guess. Come like the children, says you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. And he talks about those that put the millstones around those children's necks. Some of you in this room have millstones of your past around your necks. And they're holding you down. They're holding you down. There's things that are holding you down. And God's got a future. He's got a future. Know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, to give you a future.
Yeah.
And a hope. It says, know those plans, the Father. If there's things that are pulling you down, I'm just going to pray a couple of general prayers right now. I just feel like God doesn't want your past. Some of you feel guilty, you feel shameful. It says, well, how can God use me? Look what happened. I went, this happened, and this happened. I did this, I did that. God's under the blood.
Yeah.
It's under the blood. He's faithful and just to forgive you. Confess your faults. He's faithful and just to cleanse you from all your sins and all your unrighteousness. He's faithful. He's faithful.
Yeah.
Father, right now, I break off those millstones around people's necks. I break off the past right now. The fear, the shame. Lord, whether it's been abortion or divorce or sexual things or addictions, Father, I don't care what it is. God, your sacrifice was good enough. It was deep enough to pay the price for every sin in this room tonight, God. Things that are hindering people, they don't feel worthy. They feel like, I'm no good. Your mindset. Know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Know what God says about who you are and where you're going.
Remember,
when Henry shared years ago, you're nothing but Jacob's warm or something like that, and God came, but you know who you are in Jesus. He said, I'm calling you to go forward tonight. Break every shackle. Father, every shackle, every weight of sin that easily besets us right now, I just break it off, Father. I just break it off right now. I loose that right now. I loose that right now. Shabba, yadaba, ante. Yadaba, asiki, anda, anduri, shabda. Andali, asika. Andari asidari andari asiki andari yandari asi. I was talking to a brother this week. I met him down at the Pike Street Market. He was selling art down there, and it was a divine appointment. And I found out he used to be an Assembly of God pastor and Assembly of God evangelist, but his wife left. So he got ostracized from the Assembly of God church, which they're really good at doing to people. And I've always bothered me about. But, you know, there he is. He says, I lost everything. I'm living in Tent City right now. My wife's got I've lost it all. You know, his wife ran off on somebody. And he says, but I lost everything, and the church don't let me minister anymore. And I said, you come here, you come here, we'll open the door for you.
Hallelujah.
You know, because God wants to restore.
Amen.
That's right.
We have churches that put bondages that are not even in the Word of God. The religious devils put things on people in churches. Father, the religious institutions have put things on us and spoken words I break that off with the spirit of religion and pastors and elders and people that in authority that cursed us and put wrong words. I break those things off right now. Right now. If somebody's getting another word about something being broken, just speak it out. If you're getting a word from the Lord, just let the Lord do what He's doing. God says, don't hang on to some stuff. There's things that you're hanging on to. This is kind of a crude analogy, but it was kind of funny. You'll get the point. My son Nathan, when he was a little baby, about 1 or 2 years old, you know how kids got boogers in their nose, and he had a big booger in his nose. My wife got him in a headlock back of the room, and she pulls this thing, and Nathan's going, no, leave it alone, it's my booger. No, leave it alone. How many know we got it? It's my booger. And you know, my wife, being God, proceeds to pull it out, and she, you know, how many know God pulls things out of our lives? And she pulls it out, and she sticks it on the table, and Nathan's going, no, no, that's my booger. He's looking around, he finds his booger, he stuffs it back in his nose. You know, and I think there's sometimes, you know, God's pouring things out of your life. You got to remember that analogy, but I believe, there's things like boogers He's pulled out of your life, but you're sticking them right back on yourself. You said, yeah, I don't feel worthy, I don't feel good, and so you're just taking that snot thing and putting it right back. And God says, let that stuff go. Let it go. Let it go. Not remember anything else I said? You probably
won't. You'll never live it down.
It's not so. You'll never live it down. You get over it. Carrie, can I have you pray for the offerings? Carrie, we're going to take up one for my Father's House Ministries first. And then we're going to take up one for Brother Henry a little later on. Come on, Carrie, come up here and pray.
Oh, I thought you said Karen. Oh, no.
Well, Karen and Carrie, you both can come up.
Yeah, come on, Karen.
Karen, you can join her. If you make out a check, it's to my Father's House Ministries, and we meet every Friday and Saturday at 7, and then we meet on Mondays at 10. There might be one Friday, the last Friday of August, we might do a joint meeting with Glenn. We have a team of 10 people coming from North Carolina, and I think on that Friday, the last Friday of August, we're going to probably join them, but we'll do some meetings like Tuesday and Wednesday night in our house that week. You know, extra meetings, but then we're going to join, then I'll come back and do one on Saturday. Just keep the last, it's the Friday of Labor Day weekend, was we're having 10 people fly in. It's going to be a wonderful time. I'll share more about that in the days to come, but go ahead.
Okay, so Mike let me take the offering last week, and I told everybody it was because when I pray for the offering, everybody gives real good, real, real good. And but he told me it was just shy of $1 million last week. So let's pump it up.
Was that $1 million?
No. So Lord, we thank you so much, mighty God. We thank you for getting together on the 4th of July. Hallelujah. Yes. This is God's country.
Freedom.
This is God's country. Hallelujah. We're taking it back. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We rejoice in this day in your name, Lord. We rejoice in this place that we're gathered together. Just ask that you might, that everybody might give largely, that they might receive largely in Jesus' name. And the Lord loves a hilarious giver.
Yes.
Oh, it isn't the Lord good. Who's got a testimony as that's going around? Anyone else got a testimony you want to share? Jerry King. Sean.
I don't have a testimony, but you asked if we saw anything.
Okay, go ahead.
In your heart. While we were all praying, I just saw like a white icy hand of fear gripping people's souls. Which I feel, you know, we could break that and come against the spirit of fear right now.
Break the spirit of fear?
Yeah. So
get up here and break. Come here, Sean.
Just break that spirit of fear right now. Heavenly Father, we just come against the spirit of fear in this church right now. If anybody has, like Mike said, their past holding them back, it is a fear of the enemy. He is telling you that past is your destiny for all time, which isn't true. Because who the Son sets free is free indeed. So we come against the spirit of fear right now, and we say, be thou removed in the name of Jesus Christ. And we just call down, Father, over the minds of these people, a hedge of protection. And in that hedge, just let your love and your power and the truth of who we are in you come with it, reside in us, and change the way we think. We all battle. The biggest battle, as Joyce Meyer always says, is in the mind. And it is so true. We defeat ourselves more often than the enemy. He'll just throw a seed and we'll run with it. So, Father, we just remove those seeds. We remove that fear right now in the name of Jesus Christ. And we just agree together that we'll remember that we are supernatural beings reborn in you, and we have power and authority over all the enemy, his works of darkness, and those of his agents as well. So right now, Father, we just thank you for that remembrance and knowledge. Amen.
Amen.
I wanted to share something real quick along those lines. I'm fighting a weight battle.
What?
I know. But anyway, so I'm thinking about it and I'm fighting this battle, you know. And so this thought comes to my mind, well, you could get really sick. That would be a great way to lose weight. And I went, devil, why didn't I think of that? But, you know, I think that's just such a good example of the stupid stuff he puts in our mind that we need to just kick right out.
Amen.
Yes. Amen.
I can take you to my new theme park with all kinds of roller coasters.
Yeah.
I want to play one song before Henry comes up. Henry, I'm playing the song Henry because it reminds me of the time when God took you into the galaxies. It's a song by Paul Wilbur, but it's all galaxies and just beautiful things about home.
Oh, you're going to mess me up, man.
I'm going to mess you up. The Lord just said play this before you came on.
Our God was hard.
Hey, Henry, is that what it looked like?
To you.
Isaiah, I think it's 52, it says, you know how we know God says, you know we're going to plant. It says, the Lord says, Isaiah, you will plant the stars. How many know you can plant the stars with God? There's Creation Lab in heaven. Pat Kerr talked about Creation Lab. Eon Clayton's gone there with the Father, and actually the Lord showed him how to create, because you know what? We walk with God. There's things in God we don't even understand. But you know what? He created the universe. And I believe when we get to heaven, we get to go to creation lab and maybe create your own galaxy, you know what I mean? Who knows what God's going to do with you and things that he has for you and I. But just get ready. Don't ever put a limitation on what God is about to do. Come up here, Brother Henry. We should show. Can you turn that light on, Andre? It's one on the far left. Right there. Yeah, you might have to push the button and lift it up, or both. Yeah, I burned out two lights, so lost two lights. Oh, well. Turn it all the way up, will you?
Right. Hallelujah.
Father, we just thank you right now for Brother Henry, Father.
Yeah.
Just shared. Yeah. I just remember that time when you said you could see the stars roll up as a little kid. God took you to the heavens. You saw some of that stuff, so that's just. Better play this before you come on.
Hallelujah. You just wiped me up, brother.
That brings way back memories, Henry.
How do you follow something like that?
The testimony.
You can't do it.
I got a microphone if you want to use it up in the middle.
Yeah, maybe I better. Thank you. Hallelujah.
It's not that loud, but...
Yeah, not that loud, but it's just good enough. Ooh. Ooh. Oh, my, my. You know, after passing through the heavens into the Milky Way, there were no pictures like this. There was nothing like this yet. And I'm trying to explain it, and I just feel so inadequate. I mean, I passed a storm that had to be 5,000 miles wide. The heat looked so intense, and yet I didn't feel the heat. But I knew it was hot. You were seeing storms in the heavens there. You were seeing planets. Did you see all the planets? Did you see the colors?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
You know, I don't think there's any 6 hours in heaven CDs or DVDs left. I don't know. Maybe there are. But I just come back saying, here we have a spectrum of 8 colors in a rainbow, you know. But in the heavens, there has to be 88 spectrums. That's 8 times 88. And I was trying to share on it. 1 year after passing through the heavens, in Flagstaff, Arizona, it took me about a year to be able to talk about it, try to get my mind to understand what I had been through. You know, that Romans chapter 8, 7 through 9 is so true. The carnal mind is enmity with God. What you just viewed right there, that's just a little piece of his creation. A little piece. I mean, it is such a small portion of his creation. But that night, as I begin to try to open up and share, I talked about the planets, passing the planets, and how I knew what direction. I was sitting in a chair. I was in a sitting position when I died in that accident. I was going backwards. I went backwards through the valley of the shadow of death in a sitting position. I've never heard a testimony where anybody backslid to heaven. But I did. I was on my way to heaven going backwards. I died going backwards, I guess. I died sitting down. And I don't know what the significance is. Except that the Lord wanted to reveal it to me in a way that I guess he thought maybe I could relate it. Because for years, up to 1984, you see, from 61 to 84, that's just 23 years, but I had been exercising my senses to discern. And touch, taste, sight, smell, and hearing. You say, well, you were dead. You don't have any of those. I beg your pardon. Out of my body, I was more of a person than I am in my body right now. I don't know how to explain it, except my senses were keener. My ability to reason, my concept, my vision, comprehension was just multiplied so many times, exponentially. But that night in Flagstaff, Arizona, the Lord just opened up the eyes of my understanding, spiritual understanding. And it didn't get recorded. And I've never been able to talk on it since that night. But He let me explain the planets. He let me explain the Milky Way in ways that I can't even begin to say it now. But He was allowing me to talk what I had experienced and giving me the vocabulary to do it. Well, I didn't know the world's leading specialist on the Milky Way was sitting there listening to me that night. God set me up. Have you ever had Him set you up? I'd love to have the Lord set me up. It's just so awesome. And He come up to me right away afterwards and He said, where did you get your doctorate in astronomy?
Wow!
I said, I don't have a doctorate. He said, where did you study? I said, here, the Bible.
That's right.
He said, what telescope have you been watching the heavens through? This was in 1985, a year after the accident of 84. And my three-year-old said, that was no accident, that was a miracle. So I should be corrected by my three-year-old. But the wife and I, the wife and eight of our children in that van all survived. I mean, they hardly had a scratch. I'm the only one that died. And only because the wife said, well, if you'd have just stayed laying down, you wouldn't have got killed. But I was sleeping in the seat behind her, and she was driving. Well, when she's screaming the blood of Jesus, and the van is leaning dangerously, and you sit up and you're leaning against the outside door, leaning against the door, and you see a big boulder coming at you, would you lay down and say, oh, well. I cried the blood of Jesus. I joined in the prayer. And of course then that van caught because she was trying to get back up on the pavement up in the Siskiyou Mountains. And the winter had checked the side of the asphalt and had cracked it. And it chunks. What woke me up was her crying the blood of Jesus and chunks of asphalt as she was turning the wheel into the side of the pavement, trying to get back up on the pavement. Our son had, if God doesn't have a sense of humor, I don't know who does. Our oldest daughter had given me a cassette tape by Bill and Gloria Gaither called Fully Alive in the Spirit. And the second song on that is Then Came the Morning. I listened to that all night long, turned it over to her shortly before daybreak because my head was bobbing and I had a wife and eight children. I'm not falling asleep going off in these mountains. I almost could have killed us, you know. If I had went off, I probably would have killed everybody, but she only killed me. I made that mistake only once in Japan. How many men here have a wife that killed them? Terror broke over those Japanese people. I lost them. I said, let's forget it. I don't need to preach. They were not focused anymore. They didn't even want to stay and listen. They didn't want to see this man that had a wife that killed him. So I never used that analogy again, but it's an interesting analogy. She didn't mean to, of course. But I've been listening to that all night long, just communing with the Lord. I was already spiritually in the heavens. All night long, and taking every one of my children to the Lord, and thank the Lord for all the circumstances from their birth all the way to that night. And my wife, and just was so humbled as I heard them singing, fully alive in the Spirit. You know, I can't even sing it like they do, but Lord, make me fully alive. Well, I was singing all night, and you got to be careful what you sing. By morning, then came the morning, I was fully alive. But I had to leave my body and leave it in that van with my head crushed in the corner metal bar of the car top carrier down in my head. I had to leave that body there and to be fully alive. Now, figure that one out. But the instant I left that body, I was more of a person out of my body than I am in my body. And of course, when the last thing I heard before we went, I went into the valley of the shadow of death, or I call it a tunnel. The last thing I heard was, oh Lord, we're going over. And I had turned the wheel over to her in Big Mountains. And I thought, oh no. And I heard the crunching of metal, and then I went into the valley, the shadow of death, could hear no more. Was sitting, cupping my hands, wait a minute, you're dead. Yes, you have hands. Yes, you have ears. Yes, you can hear. Yes, you can reason. Yes, you can choose. Yes, you have a choice. But if you have enough of the truth in you, you can refuse the liar, the murderer, and the thief. If you do not have the love of the truth in you, you will not know who's speaking to you. And you will do exactly what that one said. Turn around, the light is here. And I went, no, I want to go back. My family's hurt, they need me. I wouldn't listen to that voice. Wouldn't turn around. Well, my wife killed me, but she also helped me come back alive 12 days later, because I went into depression after that, after such a glorious experience of being dead, going through those heavens, describing those heavens like you just saw. If you were sitting over here, you missed something. You needed to all get over there and look at that. I tell you, it was awesome.
That was beautiful. He had it turned.
Oh, did he?
Yeah. At least where we can all see it.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, my love. Oh, I see. It's kind of angled. Wow. Well, the pastor walked up as that man asked me where I'd got my doctorate, and asked me what periodicals you study. And then he said, then am I to believe that you actually experienced this? I said, I don't know who you are, sir. But let me tell you something. I fear God too much and the lake of fire than to run around lying to the body of Christ. I'd rather dig ditches and have blisters on my hands and have the sweat running off my nose 16 hours a day, 7 days a week, than to go and lie to the church and wind up in the lake of fire. And the pastor walked up and said, I'm sorry, Henry. He said, I should have introduced you. This is, I can't even remember his name, Dr. So-and-so. He's the head astronomer up here in the observatory. And this man said to the pastor, did you record this? And the pastor says, no, and I'm kicking myself. I've never heard such a presentation. And he said, oh. Well, he said, I took some notes. He said, do you mind if I quote you in my journals? I'm the world's leading specialist on the Milky Way. And he said, tonight, you answered the most severe questions I've had since university day. You just talk them like it's common sense. And you checked off every one of my questions and answered it so beautifully that it's the only way it could be. How did you do that? I said, I went into the Milky Way, and I am an eyewitness of the Milky Way. Hallelujah. You see, all you saw was a bunch of dots, right? Those were stars. But did you notice how the difference was from passing these storms and these planets, when all of a sudden you see nothing but all these lights, these stars? The only way I've been able to explain it since that night, a year after, and I don't remember how I explained it, except that It's kind of like the older station wagons had a seat that aimed toward the back, in the back seat. And the back window would roll down, remember?
Yeah.
They don't do that anymore. They've realized fumes come in. But it's kind of like sitting in the back seat of the station wagon. You're going down the road. It's a hard surface road. And all of a sudden, you bump off of that hard surface onto a dusty, dirt, flowery road. And the dust swirls up. And the sun is shining in your window. And before you jump off of that hard surface, you can see an occasional little dot glowing from the sun, right? When all of a sudden there's so many speckles of this illuminated by the sun coming in the window that you can't begin to count them. That's the difference between passing those planets and going into the Milky Way. But I made the statement, if you wanted, I did that in 1985, all right? That recording was in 85. My first recording of my accident experience. So then we incorporated it into 4 years later when I actually got caught up to heaven, was gone 5.5 hours. So we call it 6 hours in heaven. But only 1.5 hour was all I was dead. I mean, that's dead enough, but that's all I was dead. I know. By the time we're done tonight, you might think I'm brain dead, but it's okay. It's okay. It's all right. I met a man on this trip up in Canada that had a severe aneurysm. And he was a genius in physics and calculus and chemistry and all this. And after that aneurysm, he lost it all. And I thanked the Lord that I met the dear man. I thanked the Lord. Please understand the context of what I'm going to say. I thanked the Lord for his experience. Because after I had that bar go into my head down in my sinus cavity, a hole big enough that I stuck my thumb in after I come back alive, I tried to do Algebra 1, help my son with Algebra 1 in junior high, and I couldn't even do Algebra 1. The Lord so took away my technological mind because he had another plan for me. Hallelujah. He didn't want me messing with it. I worked with top scientists of the world in NASA, getting the men on the moon. I want to tell you something. It is no fraudulent thing. We got them on the moon. I don't care if they say, well, the flag was the wrong direction, the shadow was... Oh, come on. You've never been on the moon. How do these people become specialists all of a sudden of reflections on the moon and all these, when they've never been there? You don't know the atmosphere of the moon. See what I'm saying? But God just took it all away from me. But this dear man said, may I quote you in my journals? And I said, well, you don't have to give my name. He said, I always give my source of information. And I said, are you going to tell him I was dead and I was alive? Well, he said, if you'd like me to, yes, I'll put that in the journal. I said, please do. Because that... I was not alive when I experienced that, but the Lord let me retain it when I come back alive. Mm-hmm. And that's the awesome thing. Yeah. But you see, I made statements like, I mean, I left the earth so fast that when that thing started, the whole earth was there, right? And that's exactly what happened when I shot out of the valley of the shadow of death. The whole earth was in my periphery. And the earth was getting small this fast. That fast, I realized I was leaving the earth. And I heard a sound, and I looked right into the craters of the moon, and the whole moon was in my periphery. I can't tell you the number of people that asked me, did you see the lunar car, you know, that they made? What they call it? I call it a dune buggy, you know, a glorified lunar dune buggy. No, I wasn't looking for it. I was too busy looking at the moon and looking at the earth way back there and thinking,
did you notice?
I'm on a one-way away from the earth. My family's way down there somewhere. Now, you're dead, but yet you're very alive. Just the awesomeness of Almighty God. I said I heard every planet before I got to it. I knew what direction to look. I could hear it first. Every planet is an individually different color. In the Milky Way, Every single planet I passed was a different color. Just, that's why I come back and I said in that presentation that night with that astronomer, I said, about here we have 88 different dimensions. Here we have 8, you know, of color in the rainbow. But in the heavens, there's got to be 88 spectrums. And this astronomer said, I can verify what you're saying. He said, in our telescope, when we're studying the heavens, every planet is totally a different color. And he said, the colors are so fantastic and so beautiful. But when we print them out, what they printed out here, what this screen was showing you, was not the full color. I know it was beautiful. It's beautiful, very beautiful. But let me tell you something, it's even more beautiful than that. It's 88 times 8 more beautiful than that.
Were you seeing all kinds of different colors up there?
Oh, every planet was a different color. And he said, you had to have looked through a telescope, or you had to have studied or read this somewhere to know this, because you wouldn't have known it any other way. When we print it out to process it, it only comes back in earth colors, and that's literally what he called it. It comes back in earth colors. Heaven's colors are totally, exponentially more than earth colors. And this is something we don't understand. And I said, well, I understand it. He says, you do? Add that one on to tonight. Really blow me away. I said, well, the Lord limited the color of the earth when he gave the rainbow. It's in what you stated, see. The spectrum is the colors of a rainbow. But he limited that rainbow to one rainbow, not 88 rainbows. Know what I mean? He has limited this earth to a certain magnitude of glory, because sin came on the earth, and he had to destroy it. I know it's hard to imagine what I'm talking about, but that was beautiful. That was so beautiful. I was flying back from Tokyo, Japan, and tired. And I actually had fallen asleep. I always get a window seat, and I had actually fallen asleep with my head on the pillow against the wall, and I woke up and I looked, and here's this big screen about the size of this, you know, the bigger screen in the middle. And here is this woman flying through the heavens. Contact was the name of the movie. It was so moving. Right in that jumbo jet, I cried out loud. Start bawling out loud, and I can't stop, and I'm bawling out loud. I mean real loud. And people are looking at me, and I'm looking at them, and I grab the pillow and I bury my face in the pillow. And I'm bawling and bawling and bawling, and said, Lord, help me, I don't want to be bawling. But Lord, that took me right back to what happened. I saw something beautiful, more beautiful than they can portray. But Lord, that just took me right back to my experience of death. And I sobbed and did this for the longest time, like a little boy, you know, she stole his candy bar away from me. Somebody behind me, I never saw who it was not a man. I'm going to be all right.
Nobody asked you about that, Henry?
No, they didn't ask me what happened.
Were you afraid that you were flying through the heavens?
Was I afraid?
Did you have a sensation of fear, or was it joy?
No fear whatsoever. None whatsoever. Just
felt free, wouldn't you?
Free, totally free. Once I entered the valley of the shadow of death, I had no fear. And that's Psalms 23. I will fear no evil. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Now, that's what a shepherd uses. A rod to drive away the wolves, or the enemy, the predators. and the staff to get around the neck of the sheep and pull him up out of the place or out of thorn bushes or get a hold of him. You know, you can lift a sheep by the neck with that staff. And there have been many times walking whales, I wish I had a staff, that I'd have walked with a staff. I should have borrowed a shepherd's staff. I'd have suffered a whole lot less trying to deliver sheep from waters, from the rivers, from thorn bushes, and things like that. That was a phenomenal experience, and he confirmed several things for me. And then in 1993, I was in Boston, Massachusetts, at the Marriott Ballroom, the great Golden Ballroom, and I was sharing 6 hours in heaven, and this gentleman sitting right on the front, when I mentioned being dead, the witnesses said a minimum of 27 to 30 minutes. The moment I said that, he had a double-breasted suit on. He reaches inside his suit and pulls out a calculator and a pen and paper, and he's sitting there calculating away. And it kind of troubled me because I thought, is this presentation so boring he's going to sit right on the front and figure his checkbook or something? What's going on? You know, it did distract me. So I kind of moved away from that podium over to the other side so I wouldn't see him because it was distracting. Well, I didn't know that he was NASA's number one astrophysicist and that he was at MIT as a guest lecturer, lecturing those that were getting their doctorates in astrophysics. He was a talent scout for NASA. He was sent to find the best brains to recruit them to NASA. Well, he saw the ad in the paper of 6 hours in heaven. Well, he came to find out what this guy experienced. And as soon as I was done, he was right up there. And he said, I want to have breakfast with you. And I said, good. I wanted to say, did you get your checkbook figured? But I didn't, you know. I try to be polite. I said, well, that's fine. He says, do you leave tomorrow? I said, yes, I have to be on the plane at 11 o'clock. And he says, all right, great. 7 o'clock, good time to have breakfast. I said, on one condition. Whenever we start breakfast, that I can see the airports at Boston International taking off and landing, because I know how conversations go. And I know the city of Boston, and I don't want to get in a hurried traffic jam trying to make my flight. He says, I know just the restaurant. So that's what we got to. And he picked me up at the hotel at about 6 o'clock. We got to that restaurant. 7 o'clock, we were having breakfast. And he started telling me my presentation from an astrophysicist point of view. And it was phenomenal. I wish I'd have recorded that one. I'm only now, kind of, learning to carry a recorder, which is in my briefcase right now. So, you know, I haven't fully learned it. Rick Wiles of True News. I don't even know who Rick Wiles is. True News.
I've listened to
you. You listen to it. I've got to be on again here in the middle of this month with him, and then Hagman and Hagman. But Rick Wiles sent me a very nice little micro recorder, and he says, just turn it on and record, Henry. I want to make CDs out of it, because he says, people need to hear what you got to say. Will you do it? I will duplicate all the CDs you want of whatever you send me for nothing, just to get it into the hands of the people. Well, Rick Wiles is considered to be the top news program of the United States of America. I don't know if you know that.
No.
There are more listeners that listen to Rick Wiles than NBC, CBS, and CNN,
it's on the
Fox
web page,
News,
it's
or
on
any
web,
of those.
Though, right?
Huh?
Mostly it's on the web, right?
It's on the web, and then it's on shortwave as well. People are listening. But just a tremendous... I love being on with him. He's kind of like what's his... Sid Roth. I've been on with Sid Roth, and Sid Roth, this was when he was still on radio, not television. He hasn't caught me long enough to fly me down to Atlanta to do a taping for his television.
He's in North
program.
Carolina now. He's in Charlotte.
Is he in Charlotte now?
I was just at a
studio.
Oh, he moved up to Charlotte.
Yep.
Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah, the last time he called me to come and be on television with him, I was in Koktovik, Alaska. I don't know if you know where Koktovik is. It's the northernmost Eskimo village in the North American continent. I was walking among 68 polar bears. Hallelujah. And praying a village of 500 Eskimos. And I try to call in once a week, and so I was standing out there in about 70 below zero weather on a payphone trying to punch the buttons to get my wife on the phone, and she says, Sid Roth wants to do a program with you. He wants to fly you in to do it. I said, well, it's going to be kind of hard from Koktovik here. So she says, well, what is happening? I said, well, I'm just standing outside in my parka, and I'm trying to hear you, you know, so if I don't hear you, I'm not putting that phone against my ear. It'll freeze my ear. But I'm talking this way and hoping you'll speak loud enough that I can hear you inside my parka. It's cold out here, honey. I said, I'm looking at the Arctic Ocean, and it's solid ice. And she says, oh, my goodness, Henry, are you all right? I said, yeah, I'm fine. I just passed a mama polar bear with two cubs. I didn't know they were there until I looked and saw their little black nose and their little black eyes, and I saw the size of them, and I said, now, Mama, listen, I'm not here to feed you breakfast, lunch, or dinner. You're beautiful. The Lord made you. I've got to go make a phone call. The poor chief come up in his big outfit. You've probably seen it on National Geographic. They did do a special on National Geographic of that village, Koktovik. If you pull, you can probably pull it up. You can pull up a lot of National Geographic's productions. But he come driving up in that big vehicle that's got big wheels and real thick glass, you know, so the polar bears can't slap it and bust it and pull you out and eat you. and he takes people that fly in there on polar bear trips to see polar bears and drives right up close to them. Well, he come flying up there and says, you're going to be eaten by a polar bear. I'm not going to let you walk my village. You get in, I will drive, you pray. I said, no, it doesn't work. I have to walk. He says, you're going to be eaten by a polar bear. I said, I didn't come here to be polar bear feed. My God created them. He can protect me. He says, you are a very stubborn white man. I said, I know I am. But I don't want to have to come up here in the cold again. I want to get the job done and have it over with. Each step I take, I'm taking to get my job finished. Amen? Amen. I've learned, don't say you walked this if you didn't walk it. He'll make you go back and walk it. There's a place I had to do that. And it cost the Lord. You know, he paid the bill for the plane ticket and everything. In order to say that I'd walk completely around the country of Wales, every street, every city, every village, for 7 years, walked them all, complete circle around Wales. And I missed three streets in Bangor, Northern Wales. And that was the day the Lord asked me, before he gave me the vision of a Russian invasion and the submarine attack on America. He tested me before he gave me that. I hear a lot of people prophesy of visions and things that they had, and I don't hear any preliminary of their dedication and their commitment to the Lord. So I wonder where they got it, if they really had it or they borrowed it from someone else. Because when God gives you something of the magnitude that he gave me, he wants to be sure that you're going to obey him and you're going to do it the way he wants it done. Just as any nation tests those that they appoint to be the ambassador, they want to be sure that ambassador will represent the leader and the nation properly. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And so what the Lord had asked me that day, three streets left to go in Bangor, Northern Wales. It was 17 degrees up. My pant legs were frozen. I had fallen through the creek up to my knees. And just before noon, and by then my pant legs were frozen solid and rubbing my ankles raw, and I couldn't feel my feet. And the Lord asked me, are you willing to lay your wife and your children on the altar and never see them again this side of heaven? I had a pity party. I felt like I earned one. You ever had a pity party? I know what I said. I remember it very well. Lord, isn't it enough of a sacrifice that I flew out of Seattle the day before Thanksgiving. I was gone, I'm gone, Thanksgiving, Christmas, New Year's, walking up here in the worst time of the year that everybody says, what are you doing here this time of year? My pant legs are frozen, I can't feel my feet, and now you want my wife and my children? I don't think it's fair. That's the way I thought. So I finished those three streets. But I was testifying somewhere here in the United States, I forget where it was, one night, said I walked every street of every village and every city all the way around Wales, and the Holy Spirit said, you're a liar. Lord, was that you? Yes. That's a lie. I did, Lord, I did. Is that you or is that the devil? You know, sometimes we rebuke the devil when the Holy Spirit's speaking to us. He's so kind, he's so long-suffering with us. He gets accused a lot of times, you know what I mean? And the Lord said, Bangor, Northern Wales. After I asked you that question, you didn't pray anymore. All you did was think about your family and how they were going to die. Fear came over you. But the next word you'd get is that a gas leak was in the house blew up and all your family's gone, or the wife was taking them all shopping somewhere or something and had a bad accident, somebody drunk hit them and killed them all, or all kinds of things just flooded my mind. That's what I was thinking walking those last three streets. So I had to fly back over there and take that trip from London, go all the way up through England and head across to the northern area of Wales to Bangor and walk those three streets to be able to keep my testimony. Dr. Romanowski, he started telling me things there at the breakfast that morning as I could see planes taking off and landing. He says, Henry, number one, I'll give you what I can remember what he said. He's with the Lord now, passed away a couple years ago, cancer. Loved the Lord. He said, I believe that what you describe as the valley of the shadow of death, the tunnel, is the black hole. The black hole goes through the heavens faster than the speed of light. It swallows light. And he said, you heard a voice, and that's what Satan, that's his throne like, the black hole. And he said, he goes through the heavens swallowing light, because he hates light, because in him is no light at all. In Jesus there is no darkness, but in Satan there's no light. And so he goes through the heavens like the black hole, swallowing up light. And when Satan said to you, when that voice said to you, turn around, the light is here, you refused, because you really knew where the true light was. Remember, he said, Satan has come and transformed himself as an angel of light. But he's not. He's not light. But he transforms himself as an angel of light. And you knew it was not. You knew in your spirit, because you loved the truth, that it was not Jesus, the light of the world. That's why you threw your hand back two times and said, no, I want to go back. My family's hurt. They need me. Thank you. I'll take that. And he said, now, he said, you know when I pulled the calculator out? I says, yeah, I do, sure do, I sure do. I says, what were you doing? I thought maybe you were filling. Did you notice I stayed way over on the other side of the stage after that? Away from you, because I thought you were doing your checkbook. He laughed and he says, no. He says, when you said, the witnesses said, that you had been dead for a minimum of 27 to 30 minutes, a minimum of 27 minutes, possibly a maximum of 30, I wanted to calculate, because he said, you see, you had gone from Earth all the way to the Milky Way. And so he says the only way we have of calculating that is Albert Einstein's theory of relativity and the speed of light. And that's 186,000 miles per second. That's pretty fast, isn't it? 186,000 miles per second. And then you figure how many seconds there are in a year, and you calculate that by 186,000, you've got one light year. You see what they mean when they say so many light years away? They just they say it that way to keep you from a whole room full of zeros. it's really a nice way of saying it, you know. And so, so he said, you see, I was calculating at the speed of light how far you would get in the 27 minutes. Just took the lesser one. He said, Henry, you would only get to Saturn. You wouldn't get back.
Wow.
Do you realize how fast you had to be going? I says, no way, that's pretty fast. He says, it's incalculable. We don't have a calculation to calculate that kind of speed. I says, then help me out. Help me out. I'm going to stick my neck out here. I'm going to ask you something. This happens to me. I can glance up at a big face clock like that one there. This happened for a good 6-7 weeks after the accident. And the second hand was going backwards about this fast. And I tell my family, the second hand is going backwards. That clock is going backwards. And they say, no, it isn't, Dad. It's going forward. I said, no, it's not. It's going backwards. And as long as I stood there, it was going backwards. I'd see 5-10 minutes going backwards. And Dr. Romanowski smiled. He says, I fully understand it. I wanted to hug him. You're the first person that has even agreed that it's possible. He says, entirely possible. I have no problem with that. He said, you see, you hear on the news that astronauts, when they've been up in the space station, they come back, they have to be debriefed. That's the word we use. But he said, time will never be to those astronauts again once they've been up there. Every 22 seconds, they're going around the world. It'll never be the same to them. So we have to almost teach them about time all over again. In driving, they have a difficulty in driving with distance. They misjudge distance. They don't fit in this world anymore after they've spent time up there. Bless your heart. I don't know how to tell you how much I appreciate that. Because my wife has honeydew jobs when I go home. You know what they are. Honey, would you do this? Would you do that? And I say, yeah, I'd take you. I'd get it done in a few minutes. She says, Henry, several hours later, you're still working on it. You are the worst calculator. I said, oh, yeah. Well, I don't know why. I'm working. I'm always working. I work hard. She said, I know, but your ability to estimate time is ridiculous. You're never on. I can come closer having never done that kind of work than you can. Well, I didn't understand it. But when he told me that, I said, bless your heart. Now I've got an explanation for my wife. She may not understand it, but at least I've got understanding that I'm not crazy. Just live in a different dimension. He said, you will never live in the same dimension with time as your fellow human beings.
Wow.
You will never. Time will never be the same to you. And it really isn't. Last night in that tent, I got up to speak, and 3 hours later, I thought I had spoken for 1 hour. I looked at my watch and I could not believe what time it was. Looking for who was there. Probably nodding. Yeah, there you are. I said, it can't be 10 minutes to 10. Where did the time go? So you see, forgive me if I get carried away, if time doesn't mean anything to me. Now, I was preaching in a big church in one of the other states on the other end of this country. And on Wednesday night, it had 8,500 people in it. So it was a pretty big church in America. That's small in Korea. I've spoken in churches that will hold 44,000. And that's not a big church. Dr. Cho's church, literally on Sunday morning, they have 143,000.
Wow.
On Sunday morning. I sit there just last March in his church there with the ambassador of Israel to South Korea. And I am looking in these balconies. I'd never seen so many people in one structure in all my life. And to get them in and get them out, you ought to see the system. You talk about organization. My word. 143,000 into there in time for the service. I'm talking with 20 minutes between Sunday school and church. Sunday school is held in about the 10-story building next door. Big office complex, modern office complex. State of the art, everything. Even got coffee shops in it and everything. That through the week are offices that people lease them for business on the condition that Sunday morning it is a classroom. They're conference rooms or classrooms. And they get 143,000 from that building over into the church building in 20 minutes and they're singing and they're not still coming in. It is amazing. Talk about the... They have elevators and all that too, but phenomenal. But anyhow, I think it's all right. Lord, don't let it break. Hallelujah. Now I lost my thought here. Firecrackers are going off. It must be the 4th of July, huh?
Or New Year's Eve.
Where was I?
143,000.
143,000 before
you were in
that.
Church. Henry, did you see any life forms on any of the planets?
Did I see any life forms? No, I did not.
Too fast.
No, I didn't even see these weird guys with big eyes and funny heads and flying saucers.
How about the face of the moon?
The face of the moon was beautiful. The craters of the moon were awesome. Beautiful. They kind of looked a little bit like Sunset Crater. You ever seen Sunset Crater where the meteorite hit in northern Arizona? It's about 2 miles across. And the earth is just heaved for 20 miles on the other side where that meteorite hit. And the native tribe, the Montezuma Indians, in the path of that thing coming, all their bodies were burned on one side only. They excavated their graves and they're all burned on one side. So they know that they were on the side when the meteorite came by, whatever side they were looking the other way, their bodies burned. It killed them instantly. But it just toasted their bodies on one side. But anyhow.
They were in a church with the Israeli ambassador.
Yeah, thank you. Church with the Israeli ambassador. And that was phenomenal. That was interesting. Now, Dr. Cho was not there. I don't know if you realize that. Dr. Cho has let go of his pulpit and has turned it over to another brother that's about 47, 48 years old. Preached a wonderful sermon, and I had an hour and a half with him and the ambassador of Israel to South Korea after the service in his office. And very gracious man, very lovely man. But anyhow, what I'm saying is that I know where I started. This church had on Wednesday night about 8,500. I preached and the pastor introduced me and said, take your liberty, right? Well, if you're going to say take your liberty, doesn't that mean take your liberty?
Yeah,
are you a pastor? Now, if he says take 15 minutes, that's different, right?
Yeah.
That's a testimony, right? A very brief one for me. But he said, take your liberty. So I did. And I preached for an hour and 48 minutes without an interpreter. And that was kind of a short sermon. Well, then I prayed for people and everything. And he waited for me in the office to come in the office through the stage. Upstage, you went right through the door and right into his office. He's sitting there tapping his pen on the desk as I come in. And he says, do you say that's the Holy Spirit, what you did tonight? And I said, well, I hope so. I'm certainly in trouble with the Lord if it wasn't. He says, well, let me just get right up front with you. My opinion is, if you can't say it in 15 minutes, it doesn't need to be said. I said, well, obviously I went about 8 times over that. I'll tell you what, Pastor, you don't owe me anything. Well, he took longer to take the offering for me than he did allow, that he would have allowed me to speak. He had to have taken 20 minutes to take a love offering for me. And then he only wanted me to speak 20 minutes, 15 minutes. I'm sorry, I don't live like that. I can't preach sermonettes for Christianettes. Christianettes are not going to make it in this next day move. I mean, we are facing very serious times. And Christianettes are going to deny the Lord. They're going to walk away from the Lord. There's going to be a great falling away, and people, these that are heaping themselves to sermonette preachers, they're going to fall away. There's going to be a great falling away. If they don't love the truth any more than that, they are not going to make it. I guarantee you they're not. I'm not their judge. I'm just simply saying they don't love enough the truth. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 10. They were deceived because they received not. Oh, books under there. The love of the truth. I wonder where that came from. Are books raining from heaven? I've had jewels fall from heaven on me here when I preach, but the first time I ever had any jewels fall was two diamonds right here. Little 11-year-old girl, are you here tonight? She saw them fall, and the lovely fan that Mike loves so much blew my paper that I marked my scripture I wanted to go to on the floor, and I reached down, picked that up. And as I put it down, now I did not see diamonds sitting on the floor, but as soon as I put here, I saw a boom, sparkle go by, and I looked, and these two diamonds bounced on the floor about the size of a green pea. And that little girl sitting right where you are, boom, she saw them, and she was up so fast, and she grabbed those two and put them up to me. And I said, well, hallelujah, Mike, people, I've heard about jewels falling from heaven. This is my first. Honey, you get one, and I get one. So I gave away 50% of my first jewels. Then I was preaching over in Issaquah, in the Denny's restaurant. God chooses interesting places to let these things happen.
Oh, yeah, I was there that night.
Were you there that night?
I was, yeah.
Wasn't that awesome?
That really
sapphire hit me in the head. Who was it that picked that up and handed it to me? It was about the size of my fingernail. And then jewels just started falling. Jewels just fell, and everybody in the restaurant's coming and looking, what's going on? What's all the excitement? Jewels are falling from heaven. What? We were in the garden room, and it's plexiglass. There's no vents. There's nothing for it to fall through. Hallelujah. I love to see the Lord do things like that. Praise God. We've had a lot of jewels since then. When the Lord gives me jewels, I take them and give them away in Asia. I've given hundreds of jewels away in Asia. They cry, you know. They cry. I had six of diamonds that were pink and green and yellow and white. And I had six of them of that color combination in my pocket. They were about the size of a green pea. And I was in a church in Japan outside of Tokyo. And my interpreter, I had shown them to him. And I didn't have enough to give away. I'd already given away all but those. And those I was really treasuring them in a little container about like this. And I didn't really want to give those away yet. Amen. And this is going to be a lovely recording. If you don't realize this is the 4th of July, you will by the time this is over. Boom, boom, boom. We have an explosive atmosphere tonight.
Holy Ghost and power, the dynamite.
I think we made it more explosive than those silly things. You know? But anyhow, my interpreter says, show the pastor these jewels. And I says, no, I'm not going to show them to him in front of all the people here. They'll want them, and I don't have enough to give everybody one. And so I won't pull them out when there's too many people around. And so he talks to the pastor. The pastor comes to me and says, well, after the service, I hear you got jewels. I've heard about this from heaven. So could we meet in my study, and would you show them to me? I said, sure, as long as all the people aren't there. I'm not giving them away yet. These are mine yet. I'm still kind of hanging on to these. They were so pretty. I've given them away now, but anyhow, And so we go in the office, and here's a lady sitting there, and then the pastor's wife, and the pastor, my interpreter, thought, well, I guess I could keep two, maybe, and give away some, maybe, we'll see. But so I pull them out and put them on the table, and this lady to the right of me, the pastor's on the other side of me and his wife, phew, grabs them up so quick in that little case, and she's looking at them, and she's saying, you're not walking around with these in your pocket, are you? And I says, yeah. And she says, people would kill you for these. And I says, well, they just fell from heaven. They're just diamonds from heaven or jewels. They look like diamonds, you know. And she says, may I dump them out? And I says, sure. So she dumps them in the palm of her hand. And she's sitting there like this. I don't know if she's counting, looking at her watch or what. She says, do you know what hardness these are? No, never tested them. She said, they are the hardness of eight. I said, how do you know? She said, I'm a diamond dealer from Tokyo.
Wow.
And she said, I know jewels just by the touch, the density of them. They don't take the temperature of the body very fast, and I count so long, and if they haven't changed temperature, they still feel the same temperature, then I know what hardness they are. That's how sensitive she was. And she said, may I look at them more closely? And I said, sure. I'm watching her hands. Well, she's reaching down for her purse. I'm thinking, yeah, they're going to disappear, you know. But no, she's pulling out three different magnifying glasses. And she's putting them over in front of the lion. And she's looking up. She says, who faceted these? I want to hire them. I'll pay top dollar for whoever did this. I said, I don't think he's for sale. She said, I'm not kidding. Who faceted these? I want them. This is, I've never seen such perfect faceting. Look at this. She says, they're as even. They're faceted. This one here has a facet we don't even have a method of doing. Where did you get these? I said, they fell from heaven. She said, don't play with me. She spoke very good English. I said, I'm not playing with you. They fell out of heaven. She said, you mean God, heaven? I said, yeah. You know, it might be a mess up in translation, you know. Somebody fell out of somebody's shelf of diamonds or something. And she still had the hardest time believing that these jewels just fell from heaven. And she said, do you know the value of these? I have never seen such perfect coloring, let alone the faceting. I says, no. She said, I can't calculate it. If you had paperwork, these would be worth millions. I said, I do have paperwork.
Thank you, Jesus.
She says, don't play with me. I said, well, Malachi says in that day, you know, what does he say? The last words of the book of the Old Testament, chapter 3, verse 17. Then they that feared the Lord, if you wonder why you're not getting any jewels, do you fear the Lord enough? Ouch, I'm just trying to tell you how to get jewels. Don't get mad at me. Then they that fear the Lord, maybe you're not speaking often enough to one another, so that the Lord hearkened and listens to you. And a book of remembrance is written about you. Maybe you haven't got a book of testimonies, not enough testimonies about you yet. I don't know, I'm not your judge. I'm just taking scriptures to try to help you get more jewels. All right? A book of remembrance was written about them that feared the Lord and that thought upon his name. And they shall be mine, saith the Lord of hosts, in that day when I make up my jewels. Oh, hallelujah. And I will spare them as a man spares his own son that serves him. Hallelujah. Then shall you return and discern between the righteous and the wicked, between him that serveth God and him that serveth him not. What have I been talking to you about? What have I been teaching you about prayer walking? Don't take any thought personally. That's exactly what this verse 18 is talking about. every thought that you have through the day. If it's good, thank the Lord for it and ask Him to multiply that good. If it's wicked or evil, as it says, the wicked here, instantly look up and say, Father, I'm a tattletale. That's evil. Be a tattletale. I know, nobody likes a tattletale. I beg your pardon. Jesus is the greatest tattletale in the universe. He ever lives to make intercession for the saints. That means He is continuously telling the Father on you. He's tattling on you. He's taking your requests and your petitions to the Father for you. Hallelujah. Maybe it's not a good definition to call it a tattletale, but I'll tell you what, it means that you are continually in communion with the Father. That's what that tape means, what it means, how to commune with God. It's just simply begin to commune with God by taking every thought to Him. And believe me, you will go home from a hard day's work a whole lot more at peace. The dog won't be threatened. You won't kick the dog. You'd never kick that dog anyhow. Some people would. Get out of my way, you know. Well, he's just standing there wagging his tail. He just wants to say he's happy you're home. Like, I don't care. You don't know the day I've had at work. Well, I'll tell you what. If you get home and that's the attitude you have been violating what Jesus said when the first commandment He gave when He came back from the dead, appeared in the room where they were locked in for fear of the Jews. Some had seen Jesus alive. Others said, I don't believe He's alive till I see Him. And He appears in the middle of them. And the first thing He says to them is, peace be unto you. You know who it is. If the devil comes to you, it isn't peace be unto you. It's confusion, envy, strife, and every evil word. It's casting blame, it's coveting, you name it. But the first thing He said was, peace be unto you. And then He breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And then He said, peace be unto you again. Well, I'll tell you what, we need to have peace unto us once we receive the Holy Ghost. I was so zealous when I got the Holy Ghost that I wanted the whole world to get saved. And I tell you what, I know I was a grade A Bible thumper.
Hey, Henry, did you levitate when you got filled with the Holy Spirit? You sure
the
did.
Night before I got filled with the Holy Ghost, I levitated 2 feet up off the pew.
I did
pew.
That too. I jumped and hit and touched the ceiling.
You were touching the ceiling.
I mean,
people say, oh, that's witchcraft. I'll tell
you
what. You
were there for 2 hours.
Worshiping the Lord two hours, shaking all over. And I heard the most beautiful music, and I asked the organist, what were you playing on the organ? She said, I wasn't playing any instrument. I heard heaven singing. I heard heaven singing at 17 years old. And it was the most beautiful, harmonious music I'd ever heard in my life. And the louder that music got, I guess the higher I got off the pew. Hallelujah. But you see, I didn't get tongues that night. I got it the next night. So you see, I'm Assembly of God instead of Church of God. Are you aware of that? The great revival of 1906 in Topeka, Kansas. This was before the one at Angelus Temple down in Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. This was the one that hit first.
Yeah.
Kind of like the Pensacola. No, Toronto first. Then Brownsville. Yeah, kind of like that. Toronto, then Brownsville. Or if you want to go further back, Kansas City Fellowship. Then Toronto, then Brownsville. All right? Then if you want to go further back, then go Omaha, Nebraska. We were having one too. Hallelujah. But anyhow, where was I? Too many rabbit trails here.
17, when you were 17.
Pardon?
When you were 17.
When I was 17, yes.
Yeah,
no. The difference between Church of God or Assembly of God, okay? Yes. In doctrine. The Assemblies of God. Now, this was the foundation in Topeka, Kansas, in the Great Revival of Topeka in 1906, the year of the San Francisco earthquake, when the Missouri-Mississippi rivers flowed backwards. It was that bad of an earthquake. San Francisco was leveled, but it hit St. Louis and all that area there, and that those two rivers, the Mississippi and the Missouri, flowed backwards.
Wow.
That was a powerful earthquake. Well, anyhow. This move of God was taking place month after month, day and night, 24 hours a day. Worship, praise, and calling on the Lord, and people coming in and getting saved there in Topeka. And then
There were those that observed and noticed that there were people getting filled with the Holy Ghost, with speaking with tongues. And then there were people said, well, I was levitated 2 feet off the pew last night, and but I didn't get tongues, but I believe I was filled with the Holy Ghost. Well, you couldn't have been, said the Assembly of God Foundation people. You didn't speak with tongues yet. Yeah, but the power of God was all over me. I heard angels singing. Well, I'm sorry. And there began to be a dispute between this, and it literally destroyed the move of God over these two doctrines. So this group of people that believe you are only filled with the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking with other tongues split and went that way. The ones that said you don't have to speak with tongues yet to be filled went that way. And one went to Anderson, Indiana, where they found their headquarters called the Church of God. That's the national headquarters for the Church of God. The other one went to Springfield, Missouri, where it began to be the headquarters of the Assemblies of God. And so the revival broke over two different opinions of doctrine. Now, what happened to the Pensacola revival? Does anybody know what happened to the Pensacola revival? Why did Brownsville die? I sat in on that meeting. I can tell you as an eyewitness what happened, why it died. So many were saved, there needed to be a Bible school started, right?
Right.
And so one person in their group had a degree in seminary. And he said, I should head and be the president or the leader of the Bible school. The other one had a degree in the gifts of the Spirit and was mightily used of God in the gifts of the Spirit. And he said, but wait a minute, this is a spiritual revival. This is not an intellectual revival. So therefore, I should be over the Bible school. And neither one would give in. And the Spirit of God was grieved, and the manifestations began to die. One moved, went to Dallas, Texas. The other one stayed there, became the leader of the Bible school and of the Pensacola movement. But the move of God's Spirit has never been the same since that. So you see, two men and those that joined sides with them had the power to destroy the moving of a mighty move of God and revival. Now, why is that important to be an observer of and recognize? Because you need to remember something. Don't touch the move of God with a doctrine. The scriptures is very clear. The scriptures says this book is of no private interpretation. How do you know you've made it private? You've made it private the instant you have split fellowship with somebody because they don't believe like you do. And you stand on it. The one brother that left Brownsville just died, just late last year.
That was Steve Hill, right?
Steve Hill.
Oh, yeah.
I went to his church, opened his church. Had a beautiful church in Dallas. Now, he was not the one that said, preach 15 minutes, okay? He had a big church. Many people left Brownsville in Florida and went to Dallas to be with him. I tell you, when that man put his hand on my head to pray for me, I felt lightning. He definitely had an anointing. Whew. I hadn't felt like that since I was 17 years old in my first car coming home from night school. And I look at the fairgrounds and there's God's mighty man of faith and power, A.A. Allen.
Wow.
His big top tent. The biggest tent in the world, 19 major poles. That tent had to have been almost a half a mile long.
Oh.
Massive thing, bigger than the Ringling Brothers Barnum Bailey Circus tent. I got out of school, night school, taking my classes that summer, my preliminary classes for university. I wanted to get my degree early, so I went every summer to summer school. Take everything I could get my hands on to get my degree earlier. That was my goal. But here's his tent. And there's still a lot of cars there. He's still preaching. The healing service is still going on. I pull way out there on the edge of the parking lot, and I take off on a dead run with my high school letter sweater on, you know, and all that. And I'm running, and I get into the flap of the tent, and I'm looking down the main aisle, and here he is up there preaching, and he has just got done preaching, and he stands up there, and he says, "Now! If you want to experience the power of God, get up here." And I took off on a dead run before anybody could get up out of their seat. I was the first one up on that ramp, right in front of him, and I got the first charge. Did I get a charge? Those two hands slapped on my head. I don't remember anything for almost an hour after that. The witnesses all said, I spun in the air, went over the railing, down into the sawdust, and was rolling. I was a holy roller. I was rolling back and forth for over 45 minutes. When I came to, I heard people saying, "He's coming too." I didn't know who they were talking about. Tell you, the power of God was on me. I couldn't quit spinning. I couldn't quit rolling. I stopped spinning in the air, but I just rolling back and forth. I was so full of sawdust.
Were you suspended in the air or just... Twirling?
They said I went up in the air over this railing, off the ramp, and come down in the sawdust and was rolling back and forth in the sawdust. And I sat up and I got... I had more hair then, 17 years old. I had a head full of hair. I had sawdust down my collar. I'm pulling my shirt out. I'm shaking it out of my shirt. I'm pulling my wool leather sweater off and shaking it out, all this sawdust thing, and I'll never get all the sawdust out of that wool sweater, red and white sweater, from my lettering from sports in high school. And I said, "Wow, where did everybody go? There's probably only about 40 people sitting there." "Oh," they said, "well, they left a while ago after they prayed for you and you spun in the air." I said, "I what?" They said, "You spun up in the air when he laid hands on you. You spun over in front of us, and you were rolling back and forth." I said, "Yeah, I can tell that. I'm full of sawdust." And they said, "You've been spinning back and forth ever since." Well, I was speaking in tongues, I guess, but I didn't know it. Well, I thought that was great, except for all the sawdust. Well, I said, "I got to get home. Man, it's 11:30. I got to get up and go to school in the morning." So I hurry out, and that big parking lot, all the cars are gone. My 49 Oldsmobile sitting way out there. And I get out there and get in my car and shut the door, start the motor up. The inside of the car is all lit up. So I'm looking, where's I thought of the dome light that stuck on. The door's shut. I go to look at the dome light, it's not glowing, but in my periphery I can see in the rearview mirror, my face is glowing. I look in the mirror and I said, "I'm glowing like a light bulb. I'm glowing. Wow, I knew I had a lot of power to come on me, but that's awesome. I'm glowing. I'm glowing. Woo-hoo. I'm glowing. Hallelujah." You ever seen yourself glow? My head was lit up like a light bulb. I thought I was the only one that could see it. I went out, pulled out on the highway, the first traffic signal I stopped up, everybody's pointing, "He's glowing." I said, "Yeah, I know, I'm glowing. It's the glory of God. How that just went to A.A. Allen's meeting. He prayed for me." I don't know how many of them all the way home went to A.A. Allen's the next night. Maybe they were afraid to, I don't know. But I got home and I woke everybody up. I lit up the room. You didn't need the light on. We sit around and talked and laughed, and Mom and Dad laughed, and we praised God till the wee hours of the morning. It was real, you know. Woo. Well, some people he gives jewels, some he gives gold, some he gives feathers, no, some he gives manna. I ate a piece of bread from heaven today. That was good. I don't know what baked in heaven. I guess the Lord has to have bread up there. Hallelujah. Man shall not live by bread alone, you know. So I guess we need to have some bread. but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Well, I've gone a strange direction here tonight. This, you people, it's your fault. It's your fault. Now, I'm in my 53rd year prayer walking, and I didn't warn you ahead of time. I'm very sensitive to thoughts and questions, and I hear them. And I'll start to say something, then I'll switch over and answer it. And so I hope I've been able to answer some of your questions tonight. Did I get away from Koktovik? Did the polar bears eat me? Well, do I look like I got eaten by a polar bear? My time came to get out of Koktovik. I know where I'm going now. I've got my marker here now, so I'm going to get back to context. That was my introduction.
we go by the calendar when Henry preaches, not by the watch.
And that goes backwards.
Oh, hallelujah.
A day like 1,000 years.
Yeah, it is 1,000 years. Don't worry. I mean, the clock's still going backwards, so it's early. So we're all right. You won't get home late tonight. You'll get home before you got here. How do you figure that one? I don't know how to figure that one. But I got through walking and praying Koktovik. I got to know the chief very well, and bless his heart, he was so glad to see me get ready to leave the village, because he just would come up and say, "You're going to be eaten by polar bears. I know you're going to be eaten." I said, "No, I'm not. I refuse to give my life to a polar bear. I already gave it away to Jesus, right? Woo! I don't have a life to save. I already gave it away, so the polar bears can't have it. And besides," I told the chief, I says, "You told me yourself you really don't like polar bears. You don't like to eat them. You only like their fur. They don't like polar bears. A grizzly bear they like. I don't know what the difference is. I guess polar bear eats seals. And maybe seals don't taste as good as what grizzly bears eat, you know, berries. And maybe the grizzly bear's meat is sweeter. They eat salmon and berries.
And the odd human being.
And you, if you if they can get a hold of you." But anyhow, it came time to leave that village. And this is where I really wanted to go tonight. And so hold your thoughts, please. And I'm going to really try to get into this and get it across to you. I got in, finished in that village, and I had an appointment in the tribal center in Fairbanks, Alaska, with several tribes. And so I had to fly out of there, and I had my ticket to fly back to Fairbanks. Well, the chief wanted to drive me to the airport, and I said, "No, I'll walk. It's all right. I got my backpack, and it's okay. It's all right. I don't need a ride." He says, "Yeah, but," he says, we got 68 polar bears around here now, and they come in to eat whale blubber. You know, they'll get a whale. These whales get stuck, and you see them. There's just an opening, and they get stuck there, and they harvest them. They're allowed. That village is allowed 2 whales per year." And you may think that you may want to save the whales, but I think the Eskimos are a lot more important than the whales are. And I'll tell you why. If you've ever been among the Eskimos, you'll fully understand why. In that Arctic cold, if you eat a piece of whale blubber, it warms you up just like jalapeno peppers. It'll warm you up to you don't even want to wear a parka when it's 80 below zero. You better wear one, but you don't want to wear one. Whale blubber will really, it's fuel to your body. First time I had it, I didn't want to wear my parka, and that Eskimo up in another village said, you must wear it. You must wear it. And you know, you hang your parkas outside. You never take your parkas in the inside. Remember that. If you have a parka that has around the face and different areas, it has caribou hair. That's the value of caribous. You'd starve to death eating caribous. Caribous don't have enough protein. They're like squirrels. You would starve to death trying to live on squirrel meat. Don't think you can survive on squirrel meat. There's not enough protein. So they have to take caribou meat and mix it with mountain sheep or something like that and make it into a sausage. Then it's edible, or a moose or something like that. The highest, it's God's creation. It's very strange to our thinking. Here you have the caribou living and you have the reindeer living. They both live in the same areas. But the reindeer have the highest protein of any meat on the face of the earth.
Wow. Really?
But here you have reindeer running right beside it. You'll starve to death if you just eat reindeer. Caribou. Not reindeer. Reindeer. And so up in Siberia, I ran across where the Russians had these people that just raised the reindeer herds up near the Arctic Ocean. And they're the wildest looking people you ever saw in their life. I mean, when I walked into that terminal up there in up in Providenia, there was a whole plane load of them they just brought to get off for a while. And they saw this white man walk in. They're a native, like Native American colored skin. And they were looking at me. And they were pointing at me. They had not seen a white man.
Wow.
I thought, that's weird. And then when I reach in my bag and pull out a golden delicious apple, they about went crazy. They had never seen a golden delicious apple so perfect. I thought they were going to kill me for my golden delicious apple. Well, I found out when I got to the Green Grocer there in Providenia why. It's $5 for a half rotten one. By the time they get to Siberia, they're half rotten. And the so-called Green Grocer, they're half rotten. They're not worth eating, but $5 a piece. That's quite a jewel in my hand, considering they do good to make $36 in a whole month. So you see what I'm saying? How many apples are you going to buy when you make $36 wages in 1 month? So, but anyhow, that's a little touch of my Arctic experience. But let's get back to Koktovi. I've got an appointment. Now, I want you to think about what I'm saying. When you make a commitment to the Lord, when you make a commitment to be in a certain place with the Lord or to perform a certain duty that you've committed to the Lord, what does it take to keep you from fulfilling that? Now ask yourself that. Would it that you don't feel good, you got a headache, you just don't feel like being there that time and doing that, you'll do it tomorrow. It's raining, it's snowing or something. You know what I mean? The car doesn't want to start right away. Well, I'll just call and forget it. Think about this. Now, I had that commitment in Fairbanks at the Tribal Center. I walk up to the airport, if you'd call it that. It's a runway out in the Arctic Ocean with glaciers on both sides. The hut is about 8 foot by 10 foot. That's the radio operator's room. I go into the radio operator's room, present my ticket, and said, I'm here to catch my flight to Fairbanks. And the radio operator says, no flights come in today. Maybe no flights for 2 weeks. Ice fog. I said, but I have a ticket. He said, I don't care if you have 1,000 tickets. Ice fog. No airplane land in ice fog. They fall in Arctic Ocean, polar bears eat them. You hear that? That's a very common expression. Polar bears eat you. They must be the hungriest creatures on the face of the earth. They're always saying polar bears eat you. I said, but I have an appointment at the, thinking it's going to impress him, this Eskimo, it's going to impress him that I have an appointment at the tribal center with chiefs. He says, I don't care how many appointments you have. Ice fog. No airplane come today. I just talked to them in Nome. Tell them they leave at Nome. Don't come Koktovik. Ice fog. I said, call them up. Get them on the radio. What for? I said, I have a ticket. The poor guy's looking at me like I'm crazy. But you see, I have an appointment. I do not accept ice fog. Mm-hmm. Ice fog cannot rule my life. My God, you saw his creation here. That's just the work of his finger. course.
Right.
What is ice fog?
Yeah.
I said, I have a ticket. I have an appointment. Get him on the radio. I want to talk to the captain of the airplane. Has he gone through the pass yet? No, he wouldn't make it to pass. That'll be another 20 minutes. I said, get him on. I want to talk to him. He gets him on. The captain, I hear him just plain as can be coming through. I thought you said there's ice fog. There is. But there is a man here, white man here. He says he has ticket. The poor captain says, what am I supposed to do with that? I'm not landing in ice fog. I will go into the Arctic Ocean. This plane cannot handle that much icing. Cannot handle that much height.
You're saying twice.
See, you only thought I was preaching. I was just
going all over the world. Africa, people listen to all.
Okay.
I had to reboot my computer. That's what.
Oh, bless your hearts out there, wherever you're listening.
Yeah, Facebook.
Oh, I don't know what you're getting out of this tonight. No wonder I'm going so many directions. I don't know what thoughts are coming through that computer. Dear Lord. So you should have heard the laughter coming from that plane. He has a ticket. He has a ticket. He wants us to risk all our lives landing in ice fog. And I said to that Eskimo radio operator, give me that. You know, he had one of these little pedestal ones, like the old radio type microphones, uh-huh, with the stainless steel. That was the kind of microphone he had up there. I said, give me that. I grab it. I says, Captain, I have a ticket. He says, I know you have a ticket, but you don't fly the Arctic, obviously. I said, Captain, do you have enough fuel to come and to circle Kaktovik at least 2 or 3 times? Yeah, I could do that. I took on enough fuel to land and take off and maybe have to circle. I have enough. I said, then I have a ticket. I want you to circle. I'm going to pray. Oh, you should have heard the laughter then. He's going to pray. Hey, everybody, he's going to pray. He's going to get this. We got to see this. He's going to get rid of ice fog. This guy is a real loony. I don't know if he could know that I heard it or not, but it didn't bother me. You know, Paul said we're called fools for Christ's sake, and that's the only kind of term you're allowed to use, and it's in that context, right? Don't use it otherwise. But I said, will you do that? Will you promise me you'll circle? He said, all right, we'll circle. But I'm not coming down in ice fog. I want you to know that. I'll circle 3 times.
How low was ice fog to the ground?
Oh, you couldn't see anything for the blue haze. It was right up. The ceiling was way up there. It's a real strange color. It's a very blue haze. And it's crystals of ice that are literally in the atmosphere. Just the atmosphere is supercharged with crystals of ice that isn't falling like. It's kind of strange. It's like the pressure, the atmospheric pressure with it, holds it in the atmosphere. And when the plane comes in and hits it, it just collects ice so fast. Because the front tip of the wing have these heaters on them and de-icers on them. If ice starts building, then it has something that kind of expands the front end of that wing, and it breaks the ice off. But if it can't break it off quick enough, you go down. And they know ice fog, it's impossible. And so here he comes, and I'm out walking the runway, and this poor radio operator's yelling at me, get in here. Don't you see the polar bears on the glacier? They're going to eat you, I'm telling you, get in here. I said, I've been walking among polar bears. I got to walk this runway before they get here. He says, you're not going all the way to the end of the runway. I said, I'm going to the end of the runway and coming back. Every place the soles of my feet tread on is mine. I'm going to clear this runway in the name of Jesus. Oh, you crazy man. He ran in the hut and shut the door. He didn't want to see me get eaten by polar bears. Polar bears are watching me. They could have had me easily. Easily they could have had me. I mean, the whole thing's frozen. They just run off the height. They get up on the heights of the glaciers, you know, and they watch for seals and all, or human beings walking a runway. But they didn't come at me. I got to the end, I got back, and by the time I got back, he had circled one time. I could hear him up there, and he comes out and says, "He circled one time, you only have two times left." I said, it's all right, I'm heading on to the very end of the runway, and I can hear him go on the second one. And I can hear him about three quarters of the way around, and I know when he starts that third one, he's only going to go halfway to drop in to come down. That's the way it is. He's not going to do three and then head for a fourth. He's heading out. And I got at the end of that runway as he was heading around for that third round, and I pointed down that runway and into the heavens, and I said, "In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I rebuke this ice fog. I command you to lift and separate like Moses separated the sea. In the name of Jesus, clear up." And boom, crystal clear sky. Here comes that plane. Right in. Beautiful landing. He comes, he turns around, cuts the engine off of the port side, keeps the engines running on the starboard side, opens the door, throws a ladder out. "Throw your pack up here. Throw it up." They weren't going to drop a ladder down. They didn't want to take time to get the ladder over there. "Throw it up. Get up the ladder." Took me two throws to get my bag up there. That's heavy stuff, you know, when you wear polar gear. It isn't easy to throw. And that door was up pretty high, probably another 4 feet above the ceiling. I'm trying to get it up there, and they finally got it. "Now get up here." And I'm trying to climb up this rope ladder. I get about halfway up, and this guy reaches down, grabs my collar, and he's pulling me. I mean, they're scared. And they jerk me in, and they pull the ladder in and shut the door. And they said, "Just get up and sit down." Well, here I am sitting down right behind the pilot. And I'm not even buckled in, and he's got those engines going, and we're taking off. And away we go. We bank up in the air, and we begin to bank around toward the pass of the Brooks Range. And as we're level off heading toward the pass, he turns around and he says, "In the name of Almighty God, who are you?" He says, "I've been flying the Arctic 37 years and I've never seen anything like this. How did you do that?" I said, "In the name of Jesus." "Where did you learn that? You could have heard a pin drop in that plane, so to speak."
How many people were in the plane?
Probably about 15. A lot of these guys coming from Nome that work the oil fields up there. I was the only one from Koktovik. Hallelujah. Boy, I tell you, I got to preach the gospel all the way to Fairbanks. You know that? Woo! They all wanted to hear, you know. They had seen a miracle. Well, now listen, saints. What do you want from the Lord? You see what I'm saying? What do you want? He says here in Isaiah 62, verse 1, "For Zion's sake," that's the church. Zion is the church, right?
Yes.
"Will I not hold my peace?" God will speak for you, is what he's saying. I will speak up for you if you will stick up with me. "And for Jerusalem's sake will I not rest until the righteousness thereof go forth as brightness." You've all been predestined to shine. In John chapter 17, he says very clearly, "The glory which I had with you before, Father, I have now given them." When is now? Mike touched on it. When is now? Does now ever change? You now have the glory that he had with the Father before he came. That's a lot of glory. Remember, Moses seemed to have latched onto a little piece of that, because God said to him when he was upset and discouraged, he said to him, "I will send my angel with you." Remember what Moses said? "I don't want your angel. If you do not show me your glory, don't take me any farther. I need the glory." What is the glory? The glory is a multiplier. The glory will take the little bitty tidbit of faith that you've been operating in, and it will multiply it. It is a mustard seed. Jesus referred to it as a mustard seed. That little bit of faith as a grain of mustard seed, though it is the smallest of all seeds, I have at home in my files, right here in the University of Washington. They were granted by the federal government, agriculture department, $68,000, right here in the University of Washington, to mutate the mustard seed. That means to alter the mustard seed. They spent the $68,000, sent the report back to the National Department of Agriculture, stating it is the only seed that we know of at this time that cannot be mutated.
Hallelujah.
You know what that means? The faith of God cannot be faked. You either have it now or you don't have it. If you have it now, just like with ice fog, you act on it. You go through the process of elimination. Come and circle. You got enough fuel to circle? Yeah, three times. Then come and circle three times. I will pray. You do that part, I'll do my part. And then when it's getting down to the wire where you got to have action, you point at it and you take that authority and you declare it and you compare it with the examples that the Word of God is very clear. This Old Testament, there are people trying to eliminate the Old Testament. They're idiots. They're total idiots because it says these things in the Old Testament were written for your examples,
yes,
that you might not err when you have your wilderness experience, as they erred and fell in the wilderness. 3.5 million minus two, Joshua and Caleb. Woo! Hallelujah. Think about it, people. That's not a very good percentage. 2 out of 3.5 million. If you were a gambler, you wouldn't go against those odds. I got better sense than that if I did lose my mathematical mind. You see what I'm saying? But when it says it here, Deuteronomy 29, every time I come here, I quote that. Deuteronomy 29, 29. The secret things belong to the Lord our God. Leave those things alone. Leave the secret things alone. If you don't know what it is, you don't know what it means, leave it alone. It's none of your business. NYOB. You know what I mean. NOYB. But if it is revealed in any one of these 66 books, it's yours. I believe that. Literally or spiritually. It is yours. If he divided the Red Sea, he can divide ice fog. If he spoke to the winds and the waves and they were calm, you can speak to the winds and the waves.
Yes.
Now, some of you know this testimony. I was at 2:30 in the morning heading for the port with my interpreter in Okinawa to go to Yanaguni Island, a 6-hour boat ride from the particular island we were on in Okinawa. And I looked there, we were about to board the ferry at 4 o'clock, 4:30. And I look off in the east. Now this is in February, so there's no daylight yet. And no sun rising that's making that. And I look off in the east, and the skies are blood red. And I said to my interpreter, we better wait till the 6:30 ferry. Do you see those red skies? You ever been with sailors? I said, I worked 12 years with the Merchant Marines and the chaplaincy of the ports in this part of the Northwest. And they all said, red skies in the morning, sailors take warning. Red skies in the night, sailors delight. And he said, no, there's a forest fire up through there. I hear about it. I said, ha, that's a big forest fire. It's bigger than this island. I think we need to take the next ferry. No, he says, no, we knew. Well, we hadn't got 2 hours out on the sea with 20 people on board this little ferry, and we found out what it was all about. We got into gale force. You know what gale force is? 30-foot seas. We had a 22-foot boat. You ever been on 30-foot seas in 22-foot boat? It's mean. We are mounting, as Psalms 107 says, into the heavens, and we are plunging down into the depths of the earth, and we're afraid we're going to go all the way to hell before it stops, because it hits the bottom of those waves, it submarines, and the water comes over, and we're doing this, and the people are screaming at the top of their voices, including my interpreter. And I'm hanging on to my seat, because this is a bucking bronco ride, you know what I mean? You hit the top, and whee, whoa, wham. And that boat, when it hit the bottom, it didn't just smoothly go through like over the top. It felt like the brakes on. So you hang on, or you get thrown out of your seat. People are yelling and screaming. And then I see the two boatsmen. They're looking worried. And I thought, ooh, this is serious. When seasoned Marines are worried, you better worry. They've been out there. And then I noticed people start getting quiet and kind of turning green. I know what's next. I was thankful up to that point that we were in a closed cabin. Now I've got a decision to make. My tummy feels fine yet, but it isn't going to in a few minutes when they start heaving. This is serious. Lord, now in your word, your disciples woke you up and said, don't you care if we perish? And you said, you have little faith. I says, now I have faith, Lord, so I don't want to be called little faith. So tell me to stand up and rebuke the wind and these waves. And the Lord said, no. Remember what I said in my word also? In the last days, I will do a new thing. Oh, that means I haven't experienced it or I haven't read it. You might call that extra biblical, but it's not. It's still in the context of manifesting faith at the right time and the commandment of the Lord with nature, with the elements. I said, well, you're not going to let me rebuke the wind and the waves. I'd kind of prefer that real soon. He said, no, I want you to sing. I said, sing what? He said, sing the Song of Solomon. I had never in my life that I could remember sang out of the Book of Solomon. Song of Solomon. I couldn't remember it. It didn't come to my mind. So I get my Bible, and I open my Bible, and it comes right open, and I'm looking down at chapter 2, verse 6. I must have meant something to me. I underlined it one time. The voice of my beloved, behold, he comes, leaping upon mountains. These are mountains of water, and skipping o'er the hills. Oh, woo-hoo, upon the hills. Woo. Hey, I like that, Lord. Well, sing it. So I start singing. The voice of my beloved, lo, he comes. The voice of my beloved, lo, he comes. Leaping upon the mountains, wee-hee! And skipping o'er the hills, wee! Down we go. The voice of my... And these people are looking at me like, you have gone totally crazy. You are ecstatic. You are beyond reason. You are so afraid. You have gone out of your mind. I'm not out of my mind. Hallelujah. They're throwing up a storm. Even the boatsmen are using the buckets throwing up. It is a mess in that place in no time. I'm singing. I sang for 4.5 hours.
Wow.
I never got sick. When we got down on the wind protection side of Yonaguni Island, I jumped out of that boat onto that concrete dock. My interpreter crawled out and laid down. The others laid down on that cement dock. They wanted to be on something that wasn't moving. I knelt down beside my interpreter and I said, brother, I'm hungry. He looked at me. He said, you're crazy. I didn't just lose last night's dinner. I lost 3 days. I think I lost more than food. I don't even want to look at food. I just want to lay here. Go. I said, okay. I'm sorry. Do you want me to pray for you? No, just go. I wasn't being ornery, honestly. I really was hungry. I worked up a real appetite singing. I went up on the up in the port area there, found a little restaurant with a Philippine young girl that could speak English, and she helped me with the rest of the, you know, the order, and I got me some good old udon noodles with chicken in it, and I